To support Indonesia fight the coronavirus outbreak in 2020, Huawei provided our technology for online education and video conferencing and AI diagnosis solutions for hospitals. We partner with Indonesia's major service providers and over 400 certified local subcontractors and participate in the next Dev Summit with over 50 workshops on 5G, IoT, and digital economy, 42 service partners, and over 500 vertical customers in the government, finance, energy, transportation, and ISP sectors. We also provided smart city solutions during the Asia-Africa Summit in 2015. We lead innovation in cloud technology and artificial intelligence. We aim to build a Huawei mobile service ecosystem with our local partners. In 20 years, Huawei and Indonesia has made breakthroughs in connectivity. Together, we can build a better connected Indonesia.
Thank you. ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the session. And now let's start the next session. That is the fifth tutorial session that will be presented in the recorded material. And in this session, we have prepared for you an interesting topic on big data, trends, challenges, and opportunities presented by Dr. Amda Sahil Syed from Multimedia University, Malaysia. And this session will be led by an inspiring moderator, Dr. Imelda Atastina from Telkom University. Before giving this session, please allow me to read her curriculum vitae. Dr. Imelda Atastina is a lecturer in School of Informatics, Telkom University. She pursued her doctorate degree at School of Electro and Informatics Engineering, Bandung Institute of Technology. And her research area is on data science, big data, analytics on health and finance. So ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, let's welcome Dr. Atastina.
Thank you, Ms. Yayan. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Once more, thank you very much for your coming in this last tutorial session in ICoICT 2021. And as mentioned by our Master of Ceremony, now we are going to hear a talk about big data trends, challenge, and opportunity. And during the presentation, all of you are allowed and suggested to use the Q&A menu or chat column to write your question, and we will read the question after the presentation. So before we hear the presentation, allow me to read a brief biography of our honor speaker, Dr. Muhammad Sohel Syed. He is an associate professor in Faculty of Information Science and Technology from Multimedia University, Malaysia. He went to Multimedia University, Malaysia, and he got his Doctor of Philosophy in Engineering in 2010. His research area are biometrics, information security, image and signal processing, also pattern recognition and classification. There are some recent publication, and we hope you can enjoy the presentation. His presentation, and without further ado, our esteemed audience, please welcome Dr. Muhammad Sohel Syed.
Hello everyone, I am Dr. Muhammad Sohel Syed, Associate Professor under the Faculty of Information Science and Technology, Multimedia University, Malaysia. Today I am going to talk about the big data, trends, challenges, and opportunities. Okay, what is big data? According to a group of experts, big data are data sources that can be generally described as high volume, velocity, and variety of data that demand cost-effective, innovative forms of processing for enhanced insight and decision-making. According to a user, data so big that it becomes awkward to work with. According to Ed Dumbill and O'Reilly, what is big data? Big data is data that exceeds the processing capacity of conventional database systems. The data is too big, moves too fast, or does not fit the structures of our database architectures. To gain value from this data, you must choose an alternative way to proceed it. The three most important characteristics of big data. The first one is we call the volume. Data is aggregated from a variety of sources, including business transactions, social media, and information from sensor or machine to machine data. And next one is the characteristics of velocity. data streams arriving at an unprecedented speed and must be dealt with in a timely manner, such as RFID tags, sensors, smart metering, and banking transactions contribute the most. And next one is the variety. Data comes in all types of format, from structured numeric data in traditional databases to unstructured text documents, email, video, audio, stock, ticket data, etc. Okay, look at the three views of big data. Okay, one is the velocity, volume, and the variety. Its volume means it is from kilobyte to megabyte, megabyte to gigabyte, gigabyte to terabyte and petabyte. And the velocity is start from the batch processing, periodic, it can be periodic, it can be near real time and also real time. And if you look at the variety of data, it is coming from maybe the marketing automation, CMS, audio data, video data, web data, SMS data, social techniques data or technology data, photo data, and then mobile data, and it might be automated demand generation data. The five views of big data. First one we call the velocity, okay? That is basically speed at which data is emanating and changes are occurring between the diverse data sets. The volume, this is basically refers to the sheer volume of data being generated every seconds. The variety, it can be structured data as well as we call the unstructured data, okay? Next one is the veracity. Basically, this is data reliability and trust, verifying and validating the data. And the last one is the value. Having access to big data is all well and good, but that's only useful if you can turn it into a value. The structure of big data. Here we are talking about the two types of data. One is the structured data, one is the unstructured data. So based on the characteristics, the structured data predefined data models, usually text only, and it is easy to search. On the other hand, if you look at the unstructured data, no predefined data model. Maybe text, it may be images, it may be sound, video, or other formats, and it is difficult to search. In structured data, it resides in relational databases, and also it can be resides in data warehouses. On the other hand, unstructured data, it can reside in applications, it can be resides in NoSQL databases, data warehouses, and also it can be resides in data lakes. And the structured data is generated by humans or machines. Unstructured data also generated by humans or machine. So structured data, typical application for structured data, it can be used in airlines reservation system, inventory control, CRM systems, ERP system, etc. On the other hand, unstructured data used, typically the application used in word processing, presentation software, email clients, tools for viewing or editing media. Examples for structured data, it can be dates, phone numbers, social security numbers, credit cards numbers, customer names, it can be address, it can be product names and numbers, and transaction informations. On the other hand, unstructured data, it might be text files, reports, email messages, audio files, video files, images, and surveillance imagery. The structured data, the structure of big data, basically we define as three. One we call the structured data. This is mostly the traditional data sources coming from the traditional sources data. Next one we call the semi-structured data, main sources of big data, And the third one is unstructured data, video, audio data, etc. So semi-structured data is the combination of the structured and unstructured data. If you look at the example here, the structured data, it might be, we can say that coming from the traditional warehousing, demand forecasting in manufacturing, predictive maintenance in aerospace. Now, semi-structured data is a mix of structured and unstructured data. It might be text mining, disease analysis on electronic health record, social media sentiment analysis. It can be claims and tax fraud in public sector, etc. And then unstructured data, it can be video surveillance and analysis data. And now look at a video clip that will give you the idea of big data.
In this video, let's learn about what big data is and how it's classified. Let us begin by defining the term data. If you do a quick Google search, then you'll find that data is defined as the qualities, characters, or symbols on which operations are performed by a computer, which may be stored and transmitted in the form of electrical signals and recorded on magnetic, optical, or mechanical recording media. In simple words, we can say that all the facts and figures which can be stored in digital format can be termed as data. All the text, numbers, images, audios, videos stored in our phones and computers are some examples of data. They are all digitally stored and comprised of zeros and ones. Please remember that data is a plural term. The singular term for data is datum. The concept of big data is nothing complex. As the name suggests, big data refers to copious amounts of data, which are too large to be processed and analyzed by traditional tools. Since the amount of big data increases exponentially, more than 500 terabytes of data are uploaded to Facebook's database alone in a single day. It represents a real problem in terms of analysis. So you may be thinking that if this big data is so problematic, then why is everyone so obsessed about it? Well, the answer lies in the benefits it provides. Here are some real-world examples of the ways in which big data is used. Netflix collects user behavior data from its more than 100 million customers. This data helps Netflix in understanding what every individual customer wants to see. Based on the analysis, it recommends movies and TV shows which the viewer will love to watch. As a result, the customer is happy because he is getting what he likes without even searching for it. And Netflix is happy because it has delighted its customers, which will result in higher customer retention. Credit card companies collect and store the real-time data of when and where the credit cards are being swiped. This data helps them in thwarting fraud detection. Suppose a credit card is used at location A for the first time. Then, after 2 hours, the same card is being used at location B, which is 5,000 kilometers away from location A. Now, it is practically impossible for a person to travel 5,000 kilometers in 2 hours, and hence it becomes clear that someone is trying to fool the system. These were just two examples. Big data has hundreds of different applications in hundreds of different fields, be it banking, communication, healthcare, media, advertising, manufacturing, transportation, and retail. Big data can be used everywhere, and this is why more and more businesses are trying to harness its power. Classification is essential for the study of any subject. So big data is widely classified into three main types, which are structured, unstructured, and semi-structured data. Structured data. Structured data is used to refer to the data which is already stored in databases in an ordered manner. It accounts for about 20% of the total existing data and is used the most in programming and computer-related activities. There are two sources of structured data, machines and humans. All the data received from sensors, web logs, and financial systems are classified under machine-generated data. These include medical devices, GPS data, data of usage statistics captured by servers and applications, and the huge amount of data that usually move through trading platforms, to name a few. Human-generated structured data mainly includes all the data that humans input into computers, such as names and other personal details. When a person clicks a link on the internet or even makes a move in a game, data is created. This can be used by companies to figure out their customers' behavior and make the appropriate business decisions and modifications. Unstructured data. While structured data resides in the traditional row column databases, unstructured data is the opposite. They have no clear format in storage. The rest of the data created, about 80% of the total, account for unstructured big data. Most of the data a person encounters belong to this category, and until recently, there was not much to do except storing it or analyzing it manually. Unstructured data is also classified based on its source, machine-generated or human-generated. Machine-generated data accounts for all the satellite images, the scientific data from various experiments, and radar data captured by various facets of technology. Human-generated unstructured data is found in abundance across the internet, since it includes social media data, mobile data, and website content. This means that the pictures we upload to Facebook or Instagram handle, the videos we watch on YouTube, and even the text messages we send, it all contributes to the gigantic heap that is unstructured data. Semi-structured data. The line between unstructured data and semi-structured data has always been unclear, since most of the semi-structured data appear to be unstructured at a glance. Information that is not in the traditional database format as structured data, but contains some organizational properties which make it easier to process, are included in the semi-structured data. For example, no SQL documents are considered to be semi-structured, since they contain keywords that can be used to process the document easily. Big data analysis has been found to have definitive business value, and its analysis and processing can help a company achieve cost reductions and dynamic growth. So it is imperative that you do not wait too long to exploit the potential of this excellent business opportunity.
Okay, now look at the big data supply chain. So if you look at the left side, how big data is produced. So big data productions. Basically, they gather raw data on industry scale. It can be coming from the social media, documents, databases, web crawlers, web robots, sensors, voice, music, and video, email, RFID, call records, payment details, GPS, etc. And the second part you look at here, big data management. That means improving big data quality. So we can manage the big data. How we can do these things? So the coming from the big data productions, volume, velocity, and variety, it can be stores quality data into the databases, right? And then it can be stored as security. That means the data should be stored as securely so that we can manage the quality of data. Later on, we can do the analytics of the big data. And then the data consumption. After we improve the big data quality, we can go for commercialize the big data. So we can use data mining, we can search the big data, we can use the digital marketing, and also we can resell the big data for commercialize the big data. We can earn the money from there. Big data applications area. If you look at the big data application area, in the biotech, the big data applications area is there. In the defense sector, EPR, ERP and CRM, finance and banking sector, geoscience and weather, image and signal processing areas, mobile and telecom areas, and also in the web technology areas. The rising of big data technologies. If you look at the technologies that is rising nowadays, the first one we call this Apache Hadoop. Next one is Apache Spark, MongoDB, Cassandra, Apache, Kafka, ClickView, ClickSense, TableAO, Apache Storm, Apache Hive, Apache Pig, Presto, Apache Flink, Apache Scoop, RapidMinder, and Canine. So these are the rising big data technologies. Next, if you look at the big data system, so the first is the data capture, that means data sources, how we capture the data. So it can be coming from the user and machine generated data. It can be coming from the business, traditional enterprise financial data. It can be coming from the biomedical, bioinformatics data, social and complex network data. It can be from multimedia data, Internet of Things, IoT data, and also scientific data. And after that, we store this data. We call this is the database management. So data storage, we can store the data in the distributed file system. So we can use GFS, HDFS, IBM, GFS, or KFS, and also we can use the map RFS. All these things is actually distributed file system. We can store the data there. And after that, we can load the data. We can use the data to load into the databases. We can use NoSQL database. Then we can use the key value databases. We can use column-oriented database. We can use the document-oriented database. Also, we can use the graph databases, and we can also use memory NoSQL database. Also, you can use the SQL query tools on Hadoop. Okay, next we can go for the process of this data. So we can use the competing frameworks. It can be Hadoop MapReduce framework, it can be Apache Spark, and it can be Apache Flink. Then after that, we do the analysis of this data, and we can use the data analytics tools. It can be a machine learning library, it can be Mahout, Spark, MLlib, Flink ML. And then later on, after we analyze the data, we can visualize the data. So in that case, we can use the table AU, click view, JMP, micro strategy, and also we can use the spot file. And if you look at the big data tools, so we can use the big data tools for batch processing, for stream processing tools. We can use the interactive analytical processing tools. We can use the container orchestration tools. We can use distributed managing systems, and also we can use the data ingestion tools. Okay, now look at the application of big data analytics. So it can be used in smarter healthcare, smart farming, or precision agriculture. It can be used in the traffic control, manufacturing, multi-channel sales, telecom, trading analytics, and also it can be used in a smart city or a smart campus. Now look at the big data use cases, such as the document management and access, life sciences research. We can use in the fraud detection, web application optimization, revenue assurance, advertising analysis, churn analysis, a smart meter monitoring, warranty management, healthcare outcomes analysis, legal discovery, equipment monitoring, pricing optimizations, natural resources exploration, traffic flow optimizations, weather forecasting, IT infrastructure optimizations, social network analysis, customer behavior analysis, etc. Now look at a video clip about big data.
We all use smartphones, but have you ever wondered how much data it generates in the form of texts, phone calls, emails, photos, videos, searches, and music? Approximately 40 exabytes of data gets generated every month by a single smartphone user. Now, imagine this number multiplied by 5 billion smartphone users. That's a lot for our mind to even process, isn't it? In fact, this amount of data is quite a lot for traditional computing systems to handle. And this massive amount of data is what we term as big data. Let's have a look at the data generated per minute on the internet. 2.1 million snaps are shared on Snapchat. 3.8 million search queries are made on Google. 1 million people log on to Facebook. 4.5 million videos are watched on YouTube. 188 million emails are sent. That's a lot of data. So, how do you classify any data as big data? This is possible with the concept of five V's: volume, velocity, variety, veracity, and value. Let us understand this with an example from the healthcare industry. hospitals and clinics across the world generate massive volumes of data. 2,314 exabytes of data are collected annually in the form of patient records and test results. All this data is generated at a very high speed, which attributes to the velocity of big data. Variety refers to the various data types, such as structured, semi-structured, and unstructured data. Examples include Excel records, log files, and X-ray images. Accuracy and trustworthiness of the generated data is termed as veracity. Analyzing all this data will benefit the medical sector by enabling faster disease detection, better treatment, and reduced cost. This is known as the value of big data. But how do we store and process this big data? To do this job, we have various frameworks such as Cassandra, Hadoop, and Spark. Let us take Hadoop as an example and see how Hadoop stores and processes big data. Hadoop uses a distributed file system known as Hadoop Distributed File System to store big data. If you have a huge file, your file will be broken down into smaller chunks and stored in various machines. Not only that, when you break the file, you also make copies of it, which goes into different nodes. This way, you store your big data in a distributed way and make sure that even if one machine fails, your data is safe on another. MapReduce technique is used to process big data. A lengthy task A is broken into smaller tasks, B, C, and D. Now, instead of one machine, three machines take up each task and complete it in a parallel fashion and assemble the results at the end. Thanks to this, the processing becomes easy and fast. This is known as parallel processing. Now that we have stored and processed our big data, we can analyze this data for numerous applications. In games like Halo 3 and Call of Duty, designers analyze user data to understand at which stage most of the users pause, restart, or quit playing. This insight can help them rework on the storyline of the game and improve the user experience, which in turn reduces the customer churn rate.
Okay, now look at this picture here. So everybody is busy with their phones. That means what they are actually doing. They are maybe watching the videos. Maybe they are sending the message to their friends. So what is going on? That means every seconds, every minute, lot of data is created. Okay, look at the every 60 seconds, what is going on in the internet. That means if you look at the Facebook, 1 million login in the Facebook, 8.1 million text sends. In the YouTube, 4.5 million videos viewed, and then apps uploaded. And Google Play, 390,030 apps downloaded. Then if you look at the people tweet, 87,500 people tweeting, 2.1 million snaps created, and then 694,444 hours watched the Netflix, and in the Google, 3.8 million search queries. Just have a look at video clip. Okay, now if you look at how we look at the big data marketplace, okay? So in terms of storing data, it can be stored in the different kinds of databases. It might be Oracle, Koch database, MongoDB, Sybex, MySQL, etc. And if you want to go for the analyzing data, you can use a lot of tools here. It might be Databricks, CartIO, then it can be TableAU. All these things are the analyzing the big data. And if you look at the marketing decision with data, so you can use the click, rapid insight, you can use the good data, MetaMind, etc. And if you look at the vertical market uses of big data, so we can use all these things, Marketo, sales for marketing, we can use the click, rapid, then we can use the open gamma, etc. Okay, if you look at the growth of big data, approximately 40% of big data is actually produced each year. Okay, and so if you look at here, until 2020, it's already generated 45 gigabytes of data. That means if you think about 2021, it might be more than that. Okay, so look at here. So approximately 20 gigabyte in 2020. So 2021, it might be more than that. Okay, if you look at the unstructured data, approximately it produce 80% of the data is produced is unstructured data. Okay, so we are predicting that by 2025, it will be reached to 175 gigabyte of data. That is approximately, we can say that 90% unstructured data will be produced. Okay, now if you look at the big data industry transformations, in the transformation retail, the how the people sells their product. That means they go for a big sales, so there is a place. They go there and they put the banner, and they maybe they can give lot of big deals there. But nowadays, data-driven pricing and recommendations through the online. So online we give the discounts and also big sales, all these things we are giving there. So the people can directly buy from the online. Next, transformation of financial services. So in manual trading in the early days, you look at here in the left side, this the trading has been happened by the people. There is a place they go for trading in that particular place. Nowadays, we are using the automated high frequency trading with the online. So no need to go to the place, we can do the trading online. Next, if you look at the transformation of customer service, okay? A customer service, basically, if you look at here, if the customer is unhappy, so they can give their expressions, right? But nowadays, the customer is not giving the physical expression. They can give their comments. They can give their satisfactions, whether they're happy or unhappy in online. Transformation of transportations. Previously, we drive our car. Even still now, we can drive our car. We can go to the destination. Okay, so we can find out the place. We can ask to the people, where is this place? And then after that, we reach to our destination. So nowadays, we are using, for example, Uber, or maybe we can use the Google search. So that can give you your destinations. You just click on the where you want to go, or you can give the destinations. So the car will, the destination will show you how you can go to the place. Even now, the Google also produce a car just you give the destination, the car will automatically move to your place without driving. That means this is self-driving car. It can reach to your desired place. Okay. If you look at the transportation of cities, that means if you want to go to the city, that means your traditional infrastructure, look at here, so you can use the meter, these the traditional meters, but nowadays it has been changed. The meters is we call the smarter meters, smart transport, and also this is data-driven city design. So use also such kinds of guidance. So go to the specific location. Okay, now transportation of health and fitness. The previous we used the manual tracking. That means we can write down, walk 45 minutes, and then smoothie, left weights 20 minutes, all these things. So nowadays we have the goals and also the measurements. So we have the technology develops. So we have the all these things is already available. Okay, digital, because of digital transformations. So we can wear this one, or we can measure when you're working and how much calorie you burn, all these things. Next, transformational educations. Previously, we used the linear learning. That means we have a lot of books. We read a lot of books using the physical books. Nowadays, this is transformation has been done, and we call the adaptive learning. That means we have device here, we have ebook here. So we can download the ebook, we can read the ebook, all these things we use the adaptive learning. Okay, now look at the big data generations, how the big data is generated. So one of the way it can generate through the Internet of Things. Okay, so this is billions of devices. So if you look at the people are using the devices, so day by day, they are using the devices more and more. And in the 2020, the people here, look at here, 5.1 billion devices they are using, Internet of Things, using in this world. Next, if you look at the IoT drives real-time data. So IoT, how it generates the real-time data, if you look at this figure, so we are expecting in 2025, it will reach more than 45 gigabytes of data that will be generated by IoT drives real-time data. Okay, now look at this big data generation. Facebook generates daily 10 terabyte of data. Twitter generates approximately 7 terabyte of data. IBM claims that 90% of today's data stores data was generated in just the last 2 years. So if you look at this figure, so until 2020, that means if you look at the world populations, okay, so 2003, it was 6.3 billion. And then 2010, 6.8 billion, then 2015, 7.2 billion, 2020 is approximately 7.6 billion. And the connected device, 2003, they use 500 million, then 2010 reached to 12.5 billion, 2015 reached to 25 billion, and 2020 raised to the 50 billion, the connected device people are using. So approximately we can say that in the future, the people are using more devices. It can be the people might be used approximately maybe we can say the device more than six devices, seven devices at a time. If you look at the big data generations, so according to the Walmart, they landed more than 1 million customers transactions every hour. And the Facebook handles 40 billion photos from its its user base. Decoding the human genome that is originally took 10 years to process, now it can be achieved in 1 week. That means this kind of data, it is generated every day, every week, every month. Okay, now look at the big data generations, the big data market forecast. This is in billion US dollar. If you look at here, so we're expecting in 2021, it can be reach 48 billion US dollar. So now look at the growth of big data. That is basically the data market size revenue forecast worldwide from 2011 to 2027. If you look at here, if 2027, we're expecting it will reach more than 100 billion US dollar. Okay, if you look at the size of Hadoop and big data market worldwide from 2017 to 2020, that is in US billion US dollars. 2017, it was only 17.1 billion US dollar. But 2022, we're expecting 99.3 billion US dollar. Okay, so the growth of big data, if you look at the big data global market size forecast, by 2025, we're expecting 250 billion US dollar. By 2021, it should be, it is expecting 70 billion US dollar. Okay, now how big data is being used in the companies like Netflix. But approximately the Netflix, they have 62.3 million total Netflix users, and people watch the Netflix for 90 minutes per day. So what they do actually, with the huge user base and the long hours of the streaming, Netflix can collect from data from everyone on viewing the patterns. So how they spend time on shows, movies, and locations, the types of entertainments, it can be documentary, comedy, or drama, horror, okay? Favorite starting cast, what the favorite starting cast to the user, when the users stop watching a show, etc. And then they're using the big data, the concept, they engage the users better on current shows. They can recommend the shows they may like and create a show people would like. So they do the analysis from the user's perspectives, how they use the data, and they come up with the solutions that how they can generate more money from the users. So this is the because of they use the big data analytics, and they come up with the solutions so that they can make more profits. With the big data, 70% of the Netflix original shows are renewed for second season, and compared to 30% from the traditional TV series. That means they can earn more money based on the big data analytics, and they come up with the strategy to make more profit from there. The how the big data use in the LinkedIn. So now if you look at the collecting data from the users, the LinkedIn, they collect the data, people you may know, asking a set of questions such as, what do you do? Where do you live? Where did you go to the school? Using friends' connections. And also can be more friendly faces upfront to the keeps user engaged with the products. And after that, feeding data back to the users, they do the analysis. And then what they do, who's views your profile? They give the information to the user. By giving data back to the users, LinkedIn create a more engaging experience of users, bring more revenue, and make it more profitable for both users and company. If you look at the big data used in Disney, so Disney, they use the magnetic bands and My Magnetic Plus systems. So in the magnetic bands, the part of magnetic plus systems are linked to the credit card and the function as a park entry, as a pass, as well as the room key. So what happened in that case? So Disney is collecting tons of valuable data through the magnetic bands and My Magic Plus system, a gigantic database, and they captures every move of the visitors on the park. So they get the real-time location data, the purchase history, and they get the information about the visitors, their entertainments, riding patterns, etc. Later on, the Disney create a big data platform to store, and they process the data, they analyze the data, and they visualize data. All data is generated through the Magnetic Plus systems. And then after that, insights from the big data that enables the Disney to make smarter decisions, audience analysis, and they do also the segmentations, and they can do the recommendation engine based on the in-park traffic flow, which area the people are more engaged. So maybe they can open one more for that, you know, the one more floor for that. And the better and targeted marketing messages and offerings. So they do the analysis so they can make better marketing processing and offering the more to the people so that they can earn more money from there. So what is the future of big data? So if you look at the future of big data, so we can say that approximately 15 billion on software firms only specializing in data management and analytics. And this industry on its own is worth more than 100 billion and growing almost 10% a year, which is roughly twice as fast as the software business as a whole. And the company like the McKinsey Global Institute estimates that the data volume is growing 40% per year. Okay, the big data trends that will dominate in 2021. So number one is big data goes to the cloud. Also, second one, we say that augmented analytics. Third one is big data in IoT. Data as a service, and the number five is edge computing. So these are the big data trends that will dominate this year, 2021. Okay, reasons for the popularity of big data: better career opportunities, higher salaries, adaptation of big data by various companies, and then exponential growth of big data market. Now the top 10 high paid data science job roles of 2021. Number one, data analyst. Number two, data scientist. Number three, machine learning engineer. Number four, machine learning scientist. Number five, applications architect. Number six, data architect. Number seven, infrastructure architect. Number eight, statistician. Number nine, business intelligence analyst. And number 10, enterprise architect. Okay, so what are the challenges of big data? Of course, the challenges is big data is the security, privacy, and control. Performance of the big data, how you are going to analyze, handle this big data. Then the cost of big data is very high, how you can handle this cost. And then lastly, integration of big data. There are various types of data. How we are going to integrate, we are going to analyze, and you come up with the business models or come up with the decisions for making business or money from the big data. So these are the challenges of big data. So that's all about the big data. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Is my voice clear? Hello.
Hello.
Oh, okay. So you can hear my voice clearly. Okay. Thank you very much for your presentation, Dr. Said. It is nice presentation. So we are into a Q&A session, and there are two questions from Mr. Kemas Wiharja. I hope Mr. Said can answer it one by one. The first question is, what is the most appropriate big data technology or big data model for managing and storing IoT sensors? That's the first question for Mr. Said.
Okay, thank you very much. Actually, this is a very good question. And I think this is also very good to use, especially for the IoT. I can say that you can use the Hadoop Spark. That will be maybe most appropriate to use the big data analytics.
Okay, so the answer is Hadoop and Spark technology to support IoT problem. Okay, and the second question is, assume that we have various types of data sources such as relational documents, key values and graph data, what is the best way to store, managing and analyze this data? Should we use different tools for different type of data, or can we use an integrated tool to process this data? That's the question.
Okay, thank you very much. Actually, if you look at the different types of data, of course, we can use different types of tools. But depends upon the data type, okay? So for example, I just now told you, you can use the Hadoop and the Spark. It might be used different types of data as well, okay? So, but specifically, I think that a lot of research is going on, okay? How we are going to use different types of data, like IoT data, maybe there might be the big volume data, image data. So they have different kinds of tool, but mostly a lot of research has come up with a solution that might be solved different kinds of data to analyze. Maybe integration is coming later on, but nowadays individually we can do, but if you want to do the integration, maybe we have to do some more research on that. Okay, so still the research is going on, how we are going to solve the different kinds of data with the integrated way.
Okay. Okay. Thank you for the answer, Dr. Said. I think the answer is actually there is no optimal method for now to handle the many types of data in big data. Right. So the research is still going on to make it optimal. Yeah. Okay. There is another question. Oh, still from Mr. Kemas. Okay. How we differentiate between cloud and edge computing?
Okay. This is almost a similar thing. The cloud computing is the data that you are going to use through the cloud. And edge computing also the similar way, they also use the data, maybe that might be include the your IoT data or all these things is more on edge computing. And cloud computing data is, it can be any kind of data. But edge computing, it might be, we can say that mostly the IoT data that is related to the edge computing.
Okay, I hope you can answer the question from Mr. Kemas. We still waiting for another or any other quick question, but I have raised hand maybe. Dr. Said, are you okay if there is a direct question to you?
Okay, no problem.
Oh, okay. Okay, wait a minute. I cannot see. Okay. me the question. Is Mr. Muhammad Zikrullah want to ask the question directly? Oh, he has no access to speak. Can the committee help me to allow Mr. Muhammad Zikrullah to give the question directly? Okay, well, we wait for the technical problem. I think I have another question for you, Dr. Said. There is you in your presentation, you told us that there is a challenge related to security, performance, and so on. But can you give us just a clue? How can we start to do the research related to that challenge?
Related to the security, right?
Security, performance. You said several, okay. Several points in okay, your presentation.
First of all, you see, look at the Facebook, or we use the Twitter, right? And so the thousands, the data is generated every second, every minute, every hour. So how do you know? Because you have already given your all information to the Facebook or Twitter. So how do you know your data is secure? So this is the big challenges for us. We cannot say that our data we have given, the information, our personal information, that is secure. It might be transmitted or maybe giving to some other places. So that's why this is a very big challenge. Still, there are a lot of research is going on how we can protect our data, because we are very used to in social media. So this is a big challenge for us. So now still we are working on that. The research is going on. So maybe in future, maybe data will be protected, or so we'll know how to protect our data. Okay, another one is the question is the performance, right? So now there are huge data volumes that generated. So maybe the tools is used, appropriate tool, that might be processed very fast to give, the big data analytics output very fast. So still the Hadoop Spark is good, the tools for that, but still it's working. A lot of research is going on. Maybe in future we'll get a very good tools or frameworks that can do the processing, the big data very fast. So we can get the output maybe in the real time.
So one of the challenges is how to make it faster and faster, because the volume of the data is so tremendous. Okay,
correct.
Thank you, Dr. Said. Before we go to Mr. Kemas, I think there is another question. Where is the position of AI that will help us developing a good quality big data? And how does the process flow from big data? And then we can use it to help us make effective decision. Okay,
very, very good question, actually, this one.
Yeah.
So nowadays, the AI, artificial intelligence, is the very, the emerging areas to work. So for the big data analytics, especially for AI, now there are a lot of machine learning techniques available. So we can focus on the machine learning techniques that can analyze the artificial intelligence data. So it can be useful for making decision. For example, if we want to do some decision, let's say the customer behavior prediction. So how you can do these things? Maybe in that case, we can use some machine learning techniques. So that can predict customer behavior. And based on the customer behavior, the company can take the necessary actions for future, how can they can make good decisions for the customer will be satisfied. And maybe from that decision, they can make the business, good business or profit from there. cannot hear you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Said. Okay, we will allow Mr. Kemas to answer to ask the question directly. Please, Mr. Kemas.
Thank you, Ms. Imelda. Very nice presentation, Mr. Said. Just want to ask you about multimodal database, because we know that we have relational database for so long, and then since 1990 we have many types of not relational database coming, and then recently I saw that there are certain tools that can organize and can manage different types of database. But my question is, how we can make this multi-model database scalable? Because in big data, we need to have scalable things, right? Thank you, Mr. Said.
Okay, all right, so thank you very much. So especially if you look at the data, so we have different types of data, right? So now, if you want to handle these different types of data, then first of all, what you need to do, you need to separate this data first, okay? Now, for example, we have database like structured data, that is unstructured data, right? So if we can separate this data from this multimodal database, then we can focus on next is the tools that might use for the relational database, so we can analyze this part. Next, maybe the another part is the segregated data that is coming from unstructured data, maybe video data, audio data. So we can use the another tools for that. So this is the way I think we can manage to analyze the multimodal data.
Okay, thank
but
you
this
very
is
much.
Quite. I mean, the challenging. We have to separate this data. This is quite challenging. So still the research is going on. So that's why that, you know, the day by day we are coming with different types of tools that can solve different types of problem. So now the problem is how the multimodal data we can handle. So this is the issue or challenges.
Okay, is this enough for Mr. Kemas?
Enough. Thank you, Ms. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I think maybe I have another question for you,
sure.
Mr. Said, because I'm curious about first the veracity issue. How we can handle it efficiently? Because I think it is difficult to measure out how to we can say that this data is reliable or whatever it is. So it's difficult to measure it. Can you give us some clue or about how to handle the veracity issue?
Okay, if you think about that, that means you are talking about the data. So how do you know that data is what you call the reliable data, correct? Okay, so now if you think about the reliable data, for example, you collect some data, right? So inside the data, maybe there are some information is not you know, the acceptable. So in that case, now what we are doing, we are using the machine learning techniques. So we do the analysis and we take it out the unwanted data, we call data cleaning. So okay, if we can do the data cleaning using the machine learning techniques, then after that, we get the data, that data we can consider as the reliable data. So now it's actually the research and also some of my students are working on the, you know, the data cleaning part, how using the machine learning to clean the data so that later on this data, we can say that this is acceptable and reliable data, and that can be used for your further research. Is it clear for you? Okay.
Yeah, this is clear. But I think what if what is about if it is related to the semantic of the data, of the data, because in veracity I think it's not just about the reliability. There are some criteria to
yes, then to then we can, in that case I understand, because you're talking about the how fast we can do the analysis, right? So nowadays, of course this is also depends upon the machine, not only the algorithm or techniques we are using here. So the machine nowadays, we have also the very powerful machines that can handle the huge data to analyze within a few seconds. Understand? So now we only, not only because last time we cannot use some kind of machine learning techniques like, you know, the methods because of the limitation of the hardware. So nowadays, I think hardware is not a big issue. Now, a lot of machines also, they can do the fast processing. They have parallel processor. So I think your questions we can solve. In that case, we can use the machine that have the parallel processing power, and they have can do the fast processing to give the output very fast. Okay, so you can use the techniques, methods, as well as we need the very powerful hardware machine that can process very fast. So in combinedly both together, you can get the output very fast.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Said. There is another question, we can read it. Okay, regarding big data for IoT, can you explain the right system architecture to handle IoT data? When the data must be processed in, must be processed in real time.
Okay, so in real time data, this is a very big challenge actually. So if you want to take the real time data, you have to store the data. So of course, I already told you some of the Hadoop Spark, you can use this method, but once you want to collect the real time data, that is the one issue, is the whether this data are reliable or not. That means before we collect the data, we have to go for some data cleaning techniques. Then only after process, we can go, this data is reliable, then we can go for the analytics part. Okay, so this is actually a issue, a big issue, how the real-time data we can do the analysis. We cannot directly do the analysis. Of course, we have to go for some steps, process first. Data cleaning, then after that, we got the real data, is this useful for the analysis, then we go for the techniques only.
Okay, so maybe in short, still we can use Hadoop and Spark as the architecture for to solve the real-time IoT problem. Okay, thank you, Mr. Said. Is there any other question from the audience in the Q&A? I can't find any question. Okay, if there is no more question, I think I will give a time for there is another question. Wait a minute. Okay, from Mr. Astrid Jarin. Once the data continues to grow while our storage is limited, how is the strategy to optimize our storage capability facing growing the big data? Yeah, that's the question.
I think nowadays this can be solved very easily. Data storage also not a big issue. The hardware, and you see the cloud data, Facebook data, how we're going to store. So there is a not a big issue. I think the technology already developed. So you just find out the technology and you can store your data. So I think we can solve the problem.
Okay, so we can count to the technology, and maybe we can add some capacity planning, should we?
Yes, correct, exactly.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, that's the answer for Mr. Astrid Jarin. So you can count to the technology, because if I'm not mistaken, Hadoop and Spark, we can scale it out easily, horizontally or vertically, to solve the growth of the data. Okay. Yeah. Okay, there is another question, Mr. Said. How to determine which big data technology will fit into an organization?
How to determine which big data technology will be fit into an organization? This is depends upon the organization, actually. What kind of data they are actually handling. Different organizations, they handle different types of data. Right, so you have to think about the organizational structure and what kind of data they are going to use. For example, if you look at the telecom, so they are marketing, more on marketing, right? So they more on focus on the marketing point of view, the customer satisfactions, all these things, right? If you look at the other companies, food companies, they have different types of, you know, the data is collected. So it depends upon the organization's behavior, which data they need to collect, which data they need to analyze.
Okay, thank you for the answer, Mr. Said. Okay, we have some more minutes to answer the question. If there is another question, you can type it. Okay. Oh, thank you from Mr. Grawas Sugiharto. Okay. If there is no question, I think it is better for Mr. Said to give a short summary about the biggest opportunity or challenge in big data research area.
Please, thank you very much. Actually, there are a lot of areas to work, especially for big data. So nowadays, the people are working on, for example, sentiment analysis. They are working on the IoT and also working on the cloud computing, edge computing. Okay, in also the medical industry, there is a lot of scope to work using the big data analytics, using especially for machine learning. They're using some techniques like deep learning. I think everywhere, if you look at the nature of, company and nature of work, so big data, the future is very, 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 prominent. Okay, so the areas depends which area actually that you can focus on. It depends on the nature of the companies and their work on it. It might be big data, maybe in agriculture field, there is a lot of scopes we can work on this, especially for precision agriculture. We can work on IoT, we can work on the drone technology. Now a drone is using for collecting data, even the transfer the informations from the one place to another places. So you can get all the information using the drone also. So there are a lot of scopes we have everywhere using the big data. So okay. Scope is very big. Big data scope is very good. You need to focus on which area you want to work. It's not necessary you have to focus on only one area.
Thank you, Mr. Said. We are arrived at the end of the tutorial session. I hope this session can broaden our knowledge about big data research area. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much for your discussion, Mr. Said. So Ms. Yayan, I hand this back to you.
Thank you, Dr. Said, and also Dr. Atastina for an amazing session. And now we would like to kindly invite both of you to have a photo session. Okay, so we would like to invite the host to capture this best moment. 1, 2, 3. All right, that was very beautiful. But once again, would you please show your thumbs up to the camera? All right, that's beautiful. Okay, Dr. Said, we cannot see your thumbs up to the camera. Would you please show it?
Can I see? No.
Okay, so maybe also you would like to give your sweetest smile. in this session? By saying cheese, it's okay. Okay, all right. So 1, 2, 3. Thank you. That is amazing. So ladies and gentlemen, after this session, we will have a break. And then after that, the parallel session will take place at 1:15 p.m. in the separated rooms. And we encourage every one of you to return to the main room as we're going to have more experts to discuss about another topics. And to remind you all that at 3:30 p.m., we will have keynote sessions and also closing ceremony of in this main room. So we will have the seventh keynote session presented by Professor Dr. Hadi Susanto from Khalifa University on the title COVID-19 Modeling in Indonesia, a Mathematician's Apology. And then the eighth keynote session presented by Dr. Reza Kharshidi from the University of Oxford on the topic of From Model Fit to Market Fit, a Path Towards Turning ML Research into ML Products with Real World Fit. So once again, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the committee, we would like to say good luck to all the participants for your parallel session. And of course, we would like to kind of looking forward to your coming to our session and return to the main room to attend the next session at 3:30 p.m. on time. So see you on the next session.
Bandung Selatan di waktu malam, dalam asuhan Dewi Purnama. Cantik, mungil kesuma melati, putri manja ibunda Pertiwi. Potongan lirik lagu Bandung Selatan di waktu malam karya Ismail Marzuki tersebut seperti menggambarkan tentang keindahan sebuah tempat di bagian selatan kota Bandung. Benar saja, jika pergi ke daerah Bandung Selatan, akan banyak ditemui tempat-tempat indah yang memanjakan mata dan perasaan. Situ Patenggang menjadi salah satu dari tempat-tempat tersebut yang sayang sekali apabila dilewatkan. Situ Patenggang atau Situ Patengan adalah sebuah danau yang berada di daerah Ciwidey. Terletak di ketinggian 1.600 meter di atas permukaan laut, luas Situ Patenggang sekitar 45.000 hektar. Luas cagar alamnya mencapai 123.077 hektar. Situ Patenggang menjadi salah satu tujuan pilihan wisatawan, selain Ancol Upas dan Kawah Putih dikarenakan jaraknya yang berdekatan. Hanya membutuhkan sekitar 10 menit perjalanan jika ditempuh dari tempat wisata Kawah Putih. Banyak jalur alternatif yang dapat dilalui untuk menuju Situ Patenggang, baik itu dari Jakarta ataupun dari Bandung. Jarak tempuh antara pusat kota Bandung pada titik nol di Jalan Asia Afrika dengan Situ Patenggang yaitu sekitar 48,3 km atau 1 jam 25 menit waktu normal. Sedangkan dari Jakarta dengan titik nol di Pelabuhan Sunda Kelapa, Kota Jakarta Utara, DKI Jakarta, jaraknya kurang lebih 203 km atau 3 jam 5 menit. Untuk wisatawan dari luar kota Bandung, ada beberapa alternatif rute yang bisa digunakan untuk menuju Situ Patenggang. Di antaranya melalui pintu tol Buah Batu, Lewi Panjang, Kopo, dan Soreang, yang kemudian dilanjutkan perjalanan menuju Ciwidey sebelum akhirnya sampai di Situ Patenggang. Sementara untuk wisatawan dari daerah Bandung, pada umumnya memilih jalur Buah Batu dan Majalaya sebagai rute perjalanan menuju Situ Patenggang. Selain rute perjalanan yang tidak sulit untuk dilalui, para wisatawan juga tidak perlu takut kalau kantongnya akan kering. Dikarenakan biaya akomodasi untuk masuk ke Situ Patenggang bisa dikatakan sangat terjangkau. Tiket masuk ke area wisata adalah Rp18.000 per orang untuk weekday, dan Rp20.000 per orang untuk weekend. Kemudian untuk tarif parkir kendaraan sekitar Rp22.000 untuk bis dan Rp11.000 untuk kendaraan roda 4 lainnya. sementara untuk pengendara motor ditarif sebesar Rp3.500 per motor. Sesampainya di situ Patenggang, wisatawan akan disuguhkan dengan berbagai keindahan. Danau ini memiliki pemandangan yang sangat eksotik dan juga memiliki pemandangan alam yang asri. Karena di sekitarnya terdapat hamparan kebun teh. Di sekitaran situ Patenggang juga sudah disediakan beberapa bangunan semi permanen berbentuk pondok-pondok kecil yang bisa digunakan setiap wisatawan yang datang untuk sekedar bersantai menikmati keindahan alam sekitar, makan-makan bersama keluarga, pasangan, atau teman-teman. Di tepi-tepi danau juga tersedia perahu-perahu yang bisa disewa oleh wisatawan untuk berkeliling menikmati keindahan alam situ Patenggang. Selain itu, di jalan-jalan sekitaran danau juga ada warung-warung yang berjualan makanan dan minuman, oleh-oleh juga souvenir-souvenir yang berhubungan dengan situ Patenggang, baik itu berupa kaos, syal, topi, dan lain sebagainya.